everyone. We are live, and our guest tonight is Kate Gladstone, and she's going to be reviewing a very interesting book about writing systems and their use. And without further ado, here's Kate.
Thank you, Aya. Sorry to be a little late. I've been having a bit of fun setting up a recent birthday present, which is my nice new Mac. I'm not on the Mac right now because I thought that it would make better sense for me to have the book open on a big screen as I worked. Seemed to be having some trouble getting, since I have the book available as a PDF. Now, this book is a collection. This book is a collection of various scholarly, I would say academic essays, reports of research, and so on. We have, you know, we do have the link in the description.
Yes.
And given that it's over 300 pages, I'm not going to attempt to do much more than, you know, much more than just go over some of the highlights, which I've made into a PowerPoint. So
shall I share the PowerPoint now?
I think that would be excellent, because if you share the PowerPoint, then what I can do is simply have, I can sit here with my lovely new Mac, courtesy of my husband, who gave it to me partly because I am going to be designing fonts for some upcoming projects, and I've noodled around with the sort of software you can get on the net, like calligraph.r. But I figured that the best way to do it is to do the rough development and those sort of freebie apps, and then take it to really, you know, really complex software like glyphs.com for the rest of it. Well, Writing Systems and Their Use, edited by Dimitros Meletis and Christa Dierscheid. And if they're listening, I hope that if I said their names wrong, they will correct this. They is simply an attempt to explore the subject.
You're muted, Kate. You muted yourself.
I beg your pardon, yes. Well, this book by Dimitrios Meletis and Christa Dierscheid, and if they're listening, I'm sure that they will correct any mispronunciations I've made, and I would be grateful. This is simply, or not so simply, I should say, an over 300-page collection of academic essays, research, and so on what happens when you apply the methods of linguistics, the science of language, not just to studying speech, but to studying language. It looks as if something happened with my slides going from my system to yours. The font changed, displays got a little bit weird. I did, because of some circumstances beyond my control today, just a very crowded schedule, shall we say.
I can make it full screen like this.
That would be marvelous, but I still don't see the bottom. It's cutting off in the middle of a sentence.
Yeah.
I'm going to turn my screen this way and that way, and know that I'm afraid does not help. It's not a big deal, because normally I go and turn all my screens into graphics before I send them to you. Today did not have time to do that. I just picked a font that I hoped would be on your computer, which as it turns out isn't, and it turned it into another font and basically wrecked the spacing and so on and so forth. That's not too much of a problem, because of course I'm looking at the PowerPoint on my own system. So I can tell you that my first slide aims to say what happens when you apply linguistics methods, the methods of linguistics, the science of language, not just to studying speech, but to studying writing. Now, to begin with, I'd like to clarify some confusion about what is linguistics. Many people think linguistics means studying and learning a lot of languages and knowing how to speak, read, and write them. And most linguists do know, because of their profession, more than one language. But asking a linguist, so how many languages did you study as a linguist, is a little like asking a doctor, how many diseases did you contract in studying to be a doctor? Not that language is a disease, but to know how something works is not necessarily the same as actually having it. Linguists study how language works, the fact that there are bizarrely different systems of what speech sounds are used, in other words, phonology, and systems of what rules are used to assemble sounds into words, words into sentences. Assembling sounds into words is phonotactics, assembling words into sentences is grammar. But this does not necessarily mean that you learn in school that you must never end a sentence with a preposition on alternate Tuesdays, you know, or whatever it was. It simply means, how does the language work among those who speak the language? And of course, there can be many different grammars, many different varieties, and most of the languages we learn in school, one variety has been anointed, so to speak, as the standard variety, and you're told that's the correct variety. It doesn't mean that the others are incorrect or don't exist or don't have rules. They just have different rules, which are not accepted, just as the rules of baseball are not accepted in a game of football or cricket. Now, or the rules of American football are not accepted, you know, in football, soccer. So linguists have very normally, ever since the beginnings of the profession, which go farther back than you might think, focused primarily on speech. And you could go to the next slide if you wish. In other words, that language is what you speak, or nowadays we know in the case of deaf people have signed languages, there are signed languages, which use, by the way, the same parts of the brain, I'm told, as spoken languages do. And that's one way we know that they are languages and not just, you know, ad hoc gestures and pointing and so on. Linguists typically, when we talk about writing, I say we because I majored in linguistics in college, although I have not had as much use for that degree, simply did not go into that field. Linguists think of language as speech, and we know writing as symbols which stand for speech. And we typically think of, if we think of an alphabet, symbols that stand for speech sounds. If we are looking at Chinese, of course, it's what used to be called ideographic or logographic, the term that Meletis and Durkheim and their followers go with these days is morphographic. In other words, that morphings, units of meaning, are written, which might be units that show the meaning of what the word is or show something else about the word. And by the way, to some extent, English is somewhat morphophonemic, we're now finding. In other words, in English, we don't have a purely one-to-one sound to symbol correspondence. A lot of the variances that we do have from this relate to the shape of the word, to the word's origin, and so forth. It's not just random, for instance, that when we have a word that has come to be pronounced indict, to take a word that's very much in the news today, that it's spelled as if it were still pronounced indict. Be that as it may, linguists normally think of language as a sort of map of speech. We think of writing, rather, as a sort of map of speech, in the way that a map of the of New York City shows you things about New York, that writing shows you things about the corresponding spoken utterances. Meletis and Durkheim and their colleagues have taken the step of analyzing writing through the techniques of linguists, but doing this not just writing as a map of speech, but as a territory of its own. Just as I could send you a map of New York State and you could look at the map, use it to travel throughout New York State, but you could look at the map itself and say, well, what can we learn about the map makers from the material that the map is made of, the technique used to print it or draw it or illustrate it on, you know, Google Maps electronically, if it comes to that, what can we learn by what features are chosen to be included or excluded? For instance, a map of the New York City subway looks very different from a map of anything else in New York because only the subway routes and stops are shown. And, you know, the names of streets, but you'd never learn what the streets or the buildings actually look like. Anyway, this approach has been known as grapholinguistics. I prefer graphetics, which is a name they sometimes use, just because it's easier to say. And it's less likely to sound like, you know, gobbledygook mumbo jumbo to people who are just not used to dealing with, you know, long, long words. It's also a little less easy to confuse with things such as, you know, graphoanalysis, which is a whole other story. So what do we find? And, you know, and because I gave up very early, I would not attempt to summarize a 325-page book. We might go to the next slide and simply talk about some of the interesting things we learned. And I would say they do give examples in the book largely from research studies, but we might want to look at some of the ways that these things manifest in real life. But just to go over some of the topics they covered, which will be the next slide, they covered the differences between speaking and writing in available tools and materials. We've discussed a lot, especially here, what are the tools and materials of writing, but you may never have thought of what are the tools and materials of speech and how do they influence the result. We look at differences in how far one depends on another. Writing very heavily depends on speech. There are spoken languages that have never ever been written, quite a lot of them, but there are no current, that was a typing error, no written language have never been spoken. Okay, we have some.
Okay, okay, I know, that word didn't.
That word was not meant. I had some very bad, but let's simply say that I meant, I hope that when you put this up, you can blank out those words with a nice little bit of blue, okay?
Okay.
If you could, a little bit of blue, green gradient, okay? Because I just hope that no little children are watching.
Well, I mean, it's actually not a dirty word.
It's not, but I don't want to get nasty letters from people. Yeah. Besides,
I made two
typos in one sentence, and I rather deserve nasty letters for that. I just hope I don't get them.
Okay.
When we say spoken, and we can include the many signed languages in that, there are lots of spoken languages that have never been written down, lots of spoken languages that have been written down, but there has never been a language that was always only ever written and nobody ever, 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 ever spoke it since the dawn of its creation. Never. As far as I know and as far as they know. By the way, for what it's worth, there actually have been writing methods devised for signed languages, and at least one of them is mentioned in the book. If you ever thought that, you know, sign language could not be written, go and Google something called signwriting.org, which is the website for basically a foundation that has some deaf people and has some hearing people. And they actually at some point came up with a way to write sign languages that will work for, you know, any language that's done gesturally with the hands and or face. And it's actually based on ballet choreography. They just took the part of ballet choreography notation that relates to the parts of us that are used in signing. And they developed a system out of that. And you can literally write it. It's really cool. What's really cool is that some of it looks a bit like archaic Chinese, other than obviously different characters, but in terms of the arrangement of the symbols. Now, but what are the effects of all the differences? Is there a great divide between the way you think if you write and the way you think if you cannot write? And this is where what I thought was one of the most fascinating studies that they did, or rather two of them, bar none. And I'd like to go into these because they were so fascinating. I actually thought if you read these, you almost don't have to read the book. But I'd say read the book. Just give yourself a couple of weeks to read the book. I had to. So research on psychologists finds that there are psychological and cognitive differences between literates and non-literates. And some of this research was done by a neuropsychologist in 1930s Russia at the height of the Stalin era. And he was actually commissioned by, of course, the Stalinist government to find out something they very much wanted to find out. Were there differences in the thought processes of people in Russia who were literate and people who were not? And at the time, there were quite a lot of each because Russia had been a country full of large numbers of illiterates, a large proportion of the population, until very recently. And at the point, you know, whatever else you can say for Stalinism, a subject about which the less said the better in this context, I think, one thing that they did do was make sure, bloody well sure, that people learn to read and write. I mean, not out of any goodness of their hearts, but, you know, if you don't read and write and you cannot understand the party newspaper and you are not likely to fall in line with governmental directives if you cannot read them and have only heard them by word of mouth. So it was important, of course, to the powers that were, shall we say, to find out, well, since we're trying to reach everyone and make them literate, you know, is there anything else that changes for them if they are literate? Is there anything that we need to know about the way that the still remaining at that time millions of non-literates who are going into, you know, who are going into factories and being absorbed by a new and, shall we say, extremely demanding political system at the time, you know, we have to know what they're like. Is there any difference in you just because you can't read? And at the time, it seemed they were, because what Luria did, he went to rural places in Russia. We're talking like, you know, rural Kazakhstan. And he would do things like he'd sit down in the coffee house and make friends with them. And he'd explain that someone had basically paid him to go to different parts of the country and find out what people talked about and how their minds worked. And how he would do this, he'd sit around, he'd drink tea, you know, which is a big thing. Occasional coffee, mostly tea, sit around, smoke pipes with them. And he would get people, he'd pose them, well, logic puzzles, the kind of anything from you know, brain teasers to the sort of things that you might find on a test of logical thinking. For instance, he would ask them something like, in the region around the North Pole, 50 kilometers around the North Pole, all the bears are white. There is a bear living 40 kilometers from the North Pole. What color is the bear? And you'd expect, you know, normal, logical people say, he would say, it's a white bear. And they would say, I don't know. I've never been there. I never saw the bears. I don't know if they're white or not. I don't know if there are any bears up there. Or he'd ask them questions like, you know, my friend Dmitry lives in Kazan. In Kazan is a city where all the adults speak both the Tatar and the Russian language. Dmitry is an adult. He's grown up. What languages are you sure he knows? And they say, I don't know. I never met him. I don't know your friend. There would be other things. He would ask them questions like, you know, basically what we think of as IQ test questions, like
Well, so what you're saying is if they couldn't read, then they...
Well, that's what he thought, because he found that these people who'd never been to school and couldn't read were thinking of things very pragmatically, very differently from the way that we have learned to think of things. Now, his research seemed to say some things, but further research on a quite different population said something else. But just to give you an example, most of us, you know, are familiar with sort of one of these things is not like the others. And he would say things like, he'd show them pictures like, you know, an apple, a pear, a cherry, and a carrot. And he'd say, okay, which of these is different? And they'd say, they're all different. Or, well, you could put the apple with the pear and make fruit salad, but cherries are too small to cut into fruit salad. Or, I like cherries and I like carrots, but I don't really like apples. Or would, you know, not the answers you expect to be sort of the standard average answers people give. Now, he thought, oh, this is because they can't read. These are people who've been, you know, on the farms all their lives and they've never had a chance and their whole minds are different. And of course, you know, the Stalinists ate up this research. They loved it. It's important research, but they ate it up because to them, it's like, this proves Marxism. Your tools that you use will actually affect your mind. And they didn't have this tool, so their minds are different. And they went, you know, all Marxist and about it. And it was one, I mean, he got a lot of medals for his research. Some of it, you know, he'd done research on a lot of things, stroke survivors. He'd done a lot of topics. But this was one of the biggies. And it got quoted in psychological textbooks, even, you know, outside Russia. But there were a couple of people Gribner and Cole, and I do forget their first name, and they lived a few generations after you know, this whole Stalinist business, and they lived in the 1970s and 1980s in the USA, and they said, well, are we really checking into all the variables here? You know, if he talks to people who've never been to school and didn't know how to read and write, and he finds that they think a lot differently from the way we are sort of used to people thinking, you know, is it just because they never learned to read, or is it because they never learned to go to school? Because you go to school to a certain type of environment, you're expected to learn certain types of answers to certain types of questions, to, you know, think of everything really in a different way than before you went to school. And if you can remember your first year of school, you'll know exactly what I mean. So we have to check this out. You can't really have science if you're changing two variables and you think you're only changing one, right? So he said, let's look around. Let's see, is there any place on earth where there are people who are literate and they learn to read and write, but they don't learn it in a school type of environment or even something very similar like being tutored at home? Is there any society where we could find people who read, but they didn't learn to read from school, and no one in this society did who knows how to read, versus people in that society who don't read, or who read other languages, but ones that they learned in school, like, you know, English maybe, versus people just plain never learned to read? And they went to Liberia because there's a wide range of literacy rates in Liberia then and now. There are people who are very literate in English and other languages. Remember, Liberia began as a colony of the USA. And there are people, you know, who are living a tribal lifestyle in Africa and, you know, have never been to school. But what's interesting is that among a lot, at least one tribe of these tribal Africans, there is a fairly high literacy rate in their language called V-A-I, in their language, and it's not, and using a syllabary which someone in the tribe simply invented a couple of hundred years ago. But that is syllabary, a syllabary being a system in which each symbol represents a syllable, rather than a single sound or a word or whatever. In other words, it was invented. People learn it basically in the community, you know, by playing games, by helping each other write letters to people who have gone traveling. They, you know, it has some use in religious ceremonies, you know, but you're not taught. There's no place where you go to first grade in VI or introduction to VI 101 and you sit down and someone says, now children, here is this chart to memorize. It's just something that is acquired by a lot of very intensive, in, you know, it's part of the environment, part of the culture, because they're very proud of it because it's theirs. Mm-hmm. Well, what he found was that these people, the ones who were literate, and if they were literate only in VI, they were very literate people. That, you know, they had poems, stories, essays, you know, religious books, you know, cookbooks, you name it, you know, in their language, in their, but they thought about things not in the way that we sort of think of as normal and logical and have thought so for a very long time in the West, but they thought of things very like Alexandre Luria's pals down in the tea house in Kazakhstan. They gave practically the same answers. To give you an example, this is not from the book, but is from the original study, which of course they dug up and read. And they actually used some of the questions that Luria had done. They used those questions, they used others. For instance, and they would even try to push these people, just as Luria, by the way, had done, into seeing if they could get them to give, you know, our typical type of answers. And they couldn't. For instance, one question would be like, you know, how are a fish and a snake alike? And these people, whether they were Luria's pals in the villages in Kazakhstan or Scribner's and Cole's new buddies in, you know, the Vai villages in Liberia, would look at you and say, no, they're not alike. A fish is a fish. A snake is a snake. A fish has fins and lives in the water. A snake does not have any limbs and it lives on land. And they go on like this. And if you said to them, well, what would you say about someone who said that they were alike or had things in common? No, you know who'd say that? A darn fool. Now, I'm not saying that one way of thought or the other is right or wrong. Arguably, we need both. We need to generalize and we need to be specific. But it seems that what you get out of education, it's not something that you get specifically from, from the fact that it's literate. I mean, conversely, there has been other research, which I will say was not covered in this book, as far as I recall, that you can get a very scholastic, very school type of mind by being drilled, orally in questions and answers and repeated things without literacy being involved. We can think of a lot of situations. If you have ever been a member of certain Christian churches, or people who have, that it's possible to go to Sunday school and learn your catechism and everything without knowing how to read, And apparently it's much the same. But there are writing influence differences cross-culturally, and specifically how the members of a culture perceive their writing and perceive themselves and how they perceive their writing to relate to speaking and to relate to them. For instance, and he goes into a lot of this, if you talk with people in China, they literally find it very hard to believe, even if they've learned English, that anyone anywhere thinks of writing as representing sounds other than, there might be part of a Chinese character that gives you a clue to the sound, but they think it's totally bizarre and actually impossible that there would be a system in which a certain part of the symbol represents one particular noise and then the next part of the symbol represents, they very much will assume culturally, and it's a big part of the culture, that the thoughts came first and are irrespective of language. And it's pretty obvious that they think this because of the way written Chinese works. Because I will tell you a little personal story. You can go to the next slide if you want. I mentioned I was a linguistics major. And this was a long time ago, but I understand this still happens. In one of my classes, which happened to be the phonology class, Intro to Phonology, there was a group of students who happened to be exchange students. They were from some place in China. I forget if it was Taiwan or mainland China, but in any case, they were Chinese. Brilliant people. They, obviously qualified to be in an Ivy League university, University of Pennsylvania. They were there to study linguistics. And at some point, very, very early, the instructor was going over the differences between, how we write in, English or whatever, and the fact that there's the international phonetic alphabet, where there is literally one symbol for one sound, and you can use it to notate, any language if you know the symbols for those sounds. And there are a lot of symbols. And although these particular exchange students had I would like to say that they had no difficulty learning the system, except I can't say that because it took a long time for them to even try. Although they got it when they tried, there were about five who just walked out of the class right then. And the rest were saying, this is absolutely ridiculous. There cannot possibly be any way of writing sounds. What does writing really have to do with sounds? I mean, they were good at English and they're good at spelling English because they'd memorized all the English they saw, just like
you. Do memorize. I do have some experience with that, Kate, because I taught at the university level in Taiwan for 3 years.
God, you know more about this than I will. Tell your stories. I want to hear your stories.
Okay, so one of the things that I was surprised, because that was the beginning of my teaching career, was that when I was teaching introductory linguistics, the very first course.
Yes.
It was very hard to get the students to distinguish between a word, a syllable, and a letter, because to them, those were exactly the same, and they were all called z.
That's right, which I'm probably writing that character all wrong, trying to write it in the air.
It's that character that stands for a baby.
Did come up. They thought English was just entirely and critically, and some of them studied other languages said, you know, well, you know, you Westerners, you're entirely nuts. You know, it was as if someone came up to you and told you that a tabby cat was a different species from a white cat. You know, as opposed to just, oh, it looks different. I mean, there were a lot of dropouts, and these were people who really, really, really had wanted to study. There were, I remember, you know, one of them, you know, I was actually, you know, offered to help one of them, and it's like she just didn't get it. And I wouldn't say she didn't walk out, but she sort of, you know, just stopped showing up, you know. And I later did hear she had changed her major to something, whatever, history, whatever else. But I will tell you that to a degree, we have a little bit of such confusions, even among alphabetic language writers or speakers, or perhaps somewhat different confusions. Just to give you an example, you probably remember the late Steve Allen, the comedian. Yeah. Well, one of his non-fiction, non-comedy books that's amusing, highly serious, and I would say 99.5% is amazingly wonderful and you should read it, is a book you probably have never heard of that he wrote towards the end of his life called Dumpth, D-U-M-B-T-H. And this was a word he coined to mean the absolute stupid, obstinate state of stupid mentality that you cannot fix with any degree of argument. And the book is basically this very hysterical account of running into extraordinarily stupid people, whether they were waitresses in wet restaurants, you know, some of his fans, you know, people working in gas stations and trying to fix his car, people on television, in some instances, political dignitaries who had written letters to their supporters. And he tells these horrendously funny stories, which you can learn so much from. But at one point, he gets into some rants on people who speak English sloppily. And although I could agree with a lot of his points that it's really difficult, he says, he talks about people who mix up word meanings. I forget his specific example, but people, you know, the sort of people who say convenience and they mean both convenience and inconvenience. And he talks about how this is a problem. Well, at one point he says, and listen to how so many people, and this is where I part company with him, he says, listen to how so many people around the world and even in our good old USA where we speak English are too lazy to bother to pronounce the sound properly, because anyone can see and hear that all you have to do is put the T sound together with the H sound. Well, I happened to read this book when he was still alive, and I was a linguistics major, and it was the same year I'd had phonology, you know, like it or not. And one of the things that, you know, Steve Allen did not know, that the authors of this book very well know, they do have a section on handwriting which is immense and wonderful, and which I cannot even attempt to summarize because it was just that good, that handwriting is part of the picture. We, just as we think of handwriting as being something that is part of our individuality and don't mess with it, and we get upset if anyone talks about changing it, we tend to have a certain almost holy reverence in many cultures for what goes onto the written page, and we do not actually even want to change it, not one little bit. Now, I have seen over and over again, I mean, if you think that Steve Allen was unintentionally, ironically illustrating his own subject matter by talking about, you know, I would say if you want an example of dump, he was giving one right there. I have had the misfortune of sometimes sitting on a bus, you know, Greyhound bus going cross country, and sometimes being next to some well-meaning sweet mom or granddad or whatever reading to the kids and, you know, trying to help them begin to read, you know, reading a book, and sometimes stops and points out, oh, see this word through? This is a funny word because it has so many sounds. It has the ta sound, the ha sound, the ra sound. And I have been so close to getting up and let's just say doing things that would probably get me thrown off the bus. Don't worry, I don't do it. But I am very, very close to that. So what a lot of the book is about is how writing actually, you know, came out of a desire to represent speech, whether we were representing the word level, the syllable level, the sound level, or even, and even goes into Korean, or even the featural level, you know, and I'll get into that in a moment. We want to represent speech, but once that happens, writing actually starts to almost take over, and we start to think of that as sort of primary, mm-hmm. possibly because it's more permanent. After all, the tools of speech through all of history, where, you know, the air and your tongue, you know, you'd make a noise, it would be gone. It's only rather recently that we developed ways of, so to speak, freezing sound. By the way, I will tell you that his section on handwriting is very good. He talks about how spatial organization of the writing surface can affect how we think about what we're writing, just as much as forms and arrangements of letters and words can. I had hoped to go over the writing stuff, but I said, there's too much. I can't do it justice. I cannot pour the ocean into a thimble. I can't.
Oh, okay, Kate, in that case, yeah. Perhaps a few months from now, we could do an entire show just on the handwriting portion of this book.
I would like to, but I'm going to delve into it now. One thing that he does that's very good is that he talks about the fact that different writing systems are differently constructed, not only in what they represent, but in how these shapes are actually made. Okay, and for instance, most forms of the Roman alphabet have a structure which can be boiled down to thinking of a stick-like shape with a curve-like or more than one curve coming out of it. Not all the letters, but, you know, most of them, particularly lowercase. There's a certain visual feel you get from the Roman alphabet, what we're seeing now on the screen, at least in this lowercase form, versus what you might get from Japanese or Korean or Hebrew or Arabic or what have you. But the interesting thing is that some of these flavors, so to speak, of writing, some of these graphic identities in some languages are much closer to one another than others. For instance, he cites a story where children of various ages, 2, 3, 4, 5, were shown pictures of writing in different alphabets. For instance, a paragraph, let's say in English, and a paragraph in Hebrew, and a paragraph in Japanese, and so on. And they were asked, you know, given several of these paragraphs, to sort which ones went together and which didn't. You know, no reference made to is that this is writing, you know, just take these designs and put together the ones that you think belong together. And although people were pretty good at sorting out, okay, like they put some together, and those would be all the Japanese ones, and those would be all the Arabic ones, and those somewhere else would be, you know, all the Sanskrit ones or whatever. But a lot of them, until the age of 4 or 5, many more than you'd expect, would sort of lump the Roman and the Hebrew ones together, like basically putting a paragraph of English and a paragraph of Hebrew in the same pile. And some of them were able to articulate and say, well, these aren't exactly alike, but they're more like each other than the others are, so I think they're the same. And it wasn't until when they were 4 or 5, they did start to know the difference, but this would be even before they could read. It wouldn't be because, well, I can read this one, but I can't read that one. It would be because they started to notice some of the more subtle differences. And if you look at Hebrew, at least, you know, printed style Hebrew, which I gather was what was used, a lot of those shapes, you know, do basically have a vertical thing, and then, you know, one or more things coming off it. So the kids were, you know, not being so dumb in picking that up. And certainly those two alphabets are ultimately distantly related, more so than either of them would be to some of the other things in there. And I will tell you, one of the main purposes that this book was written was to try to actually come on a graphic classification. Imagine if we had what he would call an international graphetic alphabet, just as there's an international phonetic alphabet. In other words, if you can write every, you know, element, every feature of sound that goes into a given language so that you can accurately transcribe a language that has never been written down, notate it just as one can notate music accurately, well, we have only made a tiny start on doing anything like this for, you know, for language. In other words, there should be a way to look at a written utterance and be able to describe its components very accurately, which has been done for sign language. It has been done for, you know, spoken languages. You know, it has not been done. It would not really be easily possible for me to look at, let's say, a capital G, the way it was written by George Washington in his signature, and give some kind of verbal description that someone could translate and then know exactly what it was. Now, he does not, these authors do not present any particular system, but they do present basically techniques that they think may go towards such a system, such as evaluating, enumerating the basic shapes that a writing can be segmented into, using numerical designators to examine the particular angle of a particular stroke. Not just that K has a couple of angles, but in other words, if you specify what there is. Now, I would very much hope such a system could be worked out. I once tried to work something like this out to describe forms of handwriting and came on upper failure. So I hope he succeds.
It may be where does Braille or the writing for the blind fit into all of this?
Well, it is another form of writing. It actually discusses the fact that there are tactile writing systems and that Braille is one of them. I mean, Braille is technically also visual because if you can see, you can look at Braille dots, but that's not how Braille users do it. Braille, in other words, just as sign language is kinesthetic, Braille is kinesthetic in another sense, in that it's tactile, and the tactile placement of exactly where the dots are in relation to which other dot is very important. Otherwise, you would not be able to determine, you would not be able to discern one from another. I'm actually wondering if I can maybe, he had some very good statement about Braille, and I'm sitting here. Okay, he's got several, for instance, he's got, for instance, Braille writing is primarily tactile, but the marks are also visual. This is, I can't get the page to show up, but it's somewhere early, although that is not how Braille is perceived by people who use it. And of course, worse luck, I have destroyed the window that had, you know, that had that screen. Destroyed the window that had that screen in it, but I will soon get it back. It's all right. I'm learning to use a Mac. Last time I used any Macintosh computer was an Apple 2GS. So I think then an early version of Mac. My husband used to be a Mac person, and he introduced me to the wonderful world of Mac. Then Macs got much too expensive, and you know, we were just stuck with the Microsoft Windows for literally decades. This is the first Mac I've had my hands on in 25 years, and boy, has the technology advanced. I mean, there's stuff that is just new to me on this. I mean, I had to get it. I was looking on eBay for a whole week waiting for someone to sell an old Mac, and one that wasn't quite that old, because I needed it. Some of the font software that I decided is the best software can only be used on a Mac. And I mean, I basically was haunting eBay for a while until I found someone who'd moved up to whatever was the top of the line Mac. And he was able to do this like a month after he'd bought his MacBook Air 2020 model, 13 inches. So I got a practically new one and got some nice accessories, like a very nice case. I literally shopped around until I found a case in my favorite color. And then, by the way, I put Velcro on it so I could put Velcro on my charger and always have my charger with the case. I just get frankly sick of having to look for cords and chargers, so I've started Velcroing them to their respective devices.
That's a good practice.
Yeah, so if you don't do it, I would say, by the way, seeing me do it and hearing me explain why I need to do it finally persuaded my husband to let me do it to his computer. He ends up being perfectly fine with Microsoft, you know. I just hate working in Microsoft, you know. But he let me go and put some Velcro on, you know, his charger and his cord and his computer case. So they are now sitting up there. So that's so I will tell you that a lot of this is basically, I would say that we would probably need 3 hours to go through that chapter alone. Maybe that's what you expected that I would get in, you know, maybe that's what you expected I would do. It's what I expected I would do. But I will tell you very frankly, I got very bogged down in that chapter. And I am saying this, you know, as a handwriting person, you know, and there was just a lot to read, even though it concerned my field and, you know, and it concerned many other areas. Now, one thing I found was fascinating, it might fascinate others, although probably many of you know it already, is about Korean. And if you've ever seen its handwriting and language and so on, well, we all know about scripts that represent words or ideas. We know about Chinese. We know about the many, many scripts that represent syllables, where a symbol represents a syllable. We know about the many, many scripts that represent sounds, or sometimes small combinations of sounds, such as X standing for KS. But did you know that if we think that words are made of sounds, if we think that sentences are made of words are made of syllables, syllables are made of sounds, sounds are made of what? You can actually think of the features of a sound. For instance, is a sound produced with the, you know, through the mouth or through the nose? Is it produced with the use of the lips, of the back?
So
of
you're throat? Actually talking about articulation.
Exactly. I wanted to put it, yes, I wanted to put this very simply, but that was the word I was going to lead up to. And believe it or not, there are what are known as featural scripts, one of which is Korean. And in fact, if you look at how Korean was invented, the inventor, who was actually a Korean king back in the Middle Ages, literally chose shapes to represent things such as the position of the tongue, what part of the mouth or throat it's touching at any moment, where a sound is produced. And if you look closely at them, some of them are actually stylized outlines of the relevant articulatory organ. For instance, if you look at the Korean equivalent of N, its shape is actually a stylized nose down. I think a right angle. And if a right angle in a different place, that represents the back of the throat and is K. In other words, a K or G sound. And it's actually arranged that languages which have similar features have similar sounds with similar features have similar shapes. For instance, N is it's a basically a thing of a right angle. Go down and go to the right. Yes, it's a backwards of a Hebrew noun. It may be coincidence. That's if you think of m, m is get this. It's actually a square. It has the nasal element that n has, but it's square to basically stand for the mouth and firmly closing the mouth. Now, since those two actually are so close to things that are in Hebrew, I actually can't help but wonder, you know, did he get some of his ideas from other scripts? After all, he was royalty.
No, we know that, you know. Yeah. Remember when we reviewed the movie,
Yes, right. Yeah, he said, and I believe him. I believe it was a homegrown invention, but sometimes I look at...
Well, it's not entirely homegrown because he brought a group of scholars, a group of monks to help him. And so... Right. We're familiar with the Devanagari.
Yes, and there actually are similarities, which some of my Hindu friends who have happened to know a little Korean for whatever reason have pointed out that some of the basic shapes in Korean are similar to shapes, to parts of the shapes of Devanagari letters.
Some of them Devanagari came distantly from the Semitic writing system.
Obviously, but you know, very distantly. It's hard to see that relationship, but it is there. Anyway, I would say that this book is probably important for those who can get for those who can get through it, I would say that in terms of what we think of a, you know, by the way, have we gotten any chat? And because I would simply say,
well, here's the thing, William, you know, he's one of our contributors.
Regulars, yes.
Yes. And unfortunately, his question was, what if everyone didn't like each other, which does not seem to be.
I think I know what he's getting at. If he's probably wondering if people didn't like each other, would everyone make up their own different language? I would say, because I've often heard people talk about, oh, if we all had the same writing system or the same language or whatever, we'd all be friends and it'd be universal peace. And, you know, there are people who, you know, basically invented languages because they hoped that this would happen. But I don't think that if everyone didn't like each other, we'd each end up with our own different language, which is what I am sometimes asked. Simply because if you really don't want someone, you want to be able to talk with them to tell them how much you hate them. Also, remember that some of the bitterest wars in history have been through between peoples who spoke the same language.
Well, yes. You know, brothers always fight.
I mean, think about the various wars among that. The Scandinavian countries are pretty peaceable now, but at one point the wars were very bloody between different parts of those countries and different countries in that part of the world. Think of how many, I mean, what about the war we all learn about in history for American, the American Revolution? At the time the American Revolution happened, the Americans and English were still fundamentally speaking the same language with very little difference.
Yes, they were, in fact, the Americans were, in fact, British subjects until they liberated themselves.
Obviously, yes. I could have been more precise. You know, that's what's annoying when you look at these sort of, you know, cartoon movies that teach history and these little plays that people do in the second grade and so on, and they have Paul Revere riding around warning everyone, the British are coming. Well, whom is he warning? They're all British. He did say the Redcoats are coming. Okay? Yes. But I would say what the people who were living in America and the people who were living in England at the time, it was still the same language. A great deal of what we think of as American peculiarities in terms of vocabulary and pronunciation, even some of the grammar, things like Americans saying, I've gotten, where the British would say, I have got. A lot of that is older English and was documented in the British Isles, you know, at least a century or two before, you know, before America was, you know, America. If you, even things like, I mean, to get a little bit back into handwriting, if we think of, you know, if you ask a British person or Canadian or Australian, what is the name of the alphabet's last letter? They will all say Z. And you silly Americans, you say Z because you want everything to be the same and you can't grasp the fact that it's different. Well, some of the earliest alphabet books that were published in England actually, you know, spell out the names of the letters, you know, in some kind of alphabet book for children or for foreign languages, and say, and this is the last letter and its name is pronounced Z. There were actually different competing versions of the names of some alphabet letters, and some survived and some did not. At various times, Z in various parts of the British Isles in the late Middle Ages and early modern era had been known to people not only as Z or as Z, but depending on, you know, literally where the person was from in England who wrote your book that you learned the alphabet from, Zeta, Ezad, Izzad, Izzard, okay? Most of these did not survive, and it's just the roll of the dice that Z survived in the UK, in what's now the UK, was known a little bit in America, but died out, and Z survived here and died out in the UK. But then again, very probably it seems to have died out around the time, you know, right in the first few decades after the revolution. You know, the Americans and the English now wanted to each think of themselves as very different from one another. After all, we had already just had a dictionary that was specifically designed by someone who thought the American language should be different and should look different. He actually made a lot of changes in the first edition that were just too different for people. But there's a reason, you know, that we have color and we don't have a U in it, and we have theater and it's ER. You know, at some point, someone made it up, and at some point, you know, said, you know, we're different. Literally, Noah Webster said, we're different and our language needs to look different. Well, he thought in 200 years it would be different enough to not be understood across the ocean anyway. That didn't happen. But when you think you're different, one of the things you want to do is actually to write different. Think of all the teenage girls who get to a certain age in school and they want to be cool, and all of a sudden their handwriting is big and bubbly and maybe slanting to the left, and every I dot is not a dot but a circle or a spiral or a little heart or a ladybug or a thumbs up. You know, you've seen that, right?
Yeah. You know, we do have another comment from
Taco William. Bell and KFC. I'm not quite sure about the relevance of your comment here, Mr. Manket, although I will say that both of those things taste delicious.
If Mr. Manket, perhaps it has to do with the orthography, or you know how KFC used to be Kentucky Fried Chicken?
Yes, indeed.
And then they decided for some reason that they were no longer going to write that on.
Oh, I actually, yeah, it was not just that they were not going to write. They did marketing surveys, and they basically found that there were people who didn't like Kentucky, and they thought, they would look at Kentucky Fried Chicken, and they'd think, oh, you know, this is made by, you know, a bunch of hillbillies, a bunch of country people who don't, especially people in states that, I mean, if they're in Kentucky, they loved it being from Kentucky. You know, he'd got it, the Colonel Sanders who founded the restaurant got in some kind of honor from the Kentucky state government. But if you were in states next to that, you thought, you know, like, why would I eat their food, you know? And if you were otherwise, a lot of people, a lot of America at the time, you know, if you thought of Kentucky at all, it was a place you drove through on the way to Florida, you know? It was a place.
Isn't it also associated with horse racing?
Yeah, horse racing too, right. But certainly the Kentucky Derby is one thing, and people think of that. It's like you drive through and, okay, you stop to go to the Kentucky Derby, but they didn't think of it like, okay, they have people who race beautiful-looking horses. They have a kind of grass that is blue. And they have people who sit outside smoking corncob pipes all day, and we're talking about the women and children. Like, do you really want to eat food from there? Now, and of course, since they found that there were some people calling it KFC anyway because of not liking the name, and they found that people abbreviated it. And if you abbreviate something, if you want to leave someone a note about what to get for takeout dinner, if you want a quick dinner, you might be a little more likely to tell them to stop at KFC than, honey, stop at Kentucky Fried Chicken, especially back when you were writing everything out. I mean, nowadays, if you tell your husband to go to pick up things from KFC a lot, you probably have it stored as a text shortcut on your phone, and you just type like KFC food or something, and the message goes out, you know? But, you know, that's now. This was then. And, of course, there are always things that we do in writing to do the opposite, to make places look super sophisticated. How many times have you been in a fancy restaurant or any kind of store that called itself the whatever it was shop, like the hair shop, the flower shop, but they spell shop S-H-O-P-P-E. And yes, they'll tell you it's French. But it's no more French than you are or I am. Someone decided to stick a French-looking ending on the end of the word shop because, you know, a shop is boring. Your shop is where a guy sits and he's got his shop and he works on his plumbing, you know, pipe repairs or your pipe fitting. You know, but a shop, S-H-O-P-P-E, you know, that's where you take your dog to get shampooed and get, you know, a curly hairdo, the dog shop. Or I actually know a place of a place that is actually an occupational therapy supply store that calls itself the therapy shop, S-H-O-P-P-E, because they think of themselves as being a little sort of very boutique-y place. I mean, they're not wrong. Their stuff is very nice and very classy. And I'm not just saying this because, you know, sometimes they resell some of my stuff, you know, if they're listening, you know, If you're listening, Colleen and Renee, this goes out to you. They're probably not listening. I just didn't have time to tell people beforehand. I will have a little time to tell people afterwards, but I have about half a dozen magazine articles and two columns to finish, and foreseeably this is going to take up the weekend because I've been trying to get to sleep earlier. Anyway, think of how many times you have seen, you know, for some people it's a big deal, and he touches on this a little, as I recall, about how people spell not just everyday words, but, you know, but think of how we spell our own names. Think of how many people named Smith out there. You know, used to be a joke that if Smith struck it rich, you know, if he struck oil or made a killing in the stock market, one day he'd show up and he'd no longer be Smith. He'd be Smythe, S-M-Y-T-H-E. How cool. Even if he was still pronouncing it Smith, which he might have been. At one point, I will be looking after this show, just because this came up and didn't anticipate it, for literally a poem that's about 100 years old, which is about people literally changing the spelling of their names as they moved up in the social ladder. In other words, if your family, you know, for instance, you know, in other words, literally people who would look down on someone whose name was Sims, S-I-M-S, until he started to be all aristocratic and spell it S-Y-M-M-E-S. And then all of a sudden, he was someone you'd be proud to know. And the poem is full of examples like this. A little outdated, but I think most of us have known someone who got creative with the spelling of their first name, if not their last name. Think of how many ways there are to spell Catherine, for instance. And that's one of the more normal ones. Think of how many times you have known someone whose name was Dolores, let's say, who suddenly either stopped spelling it Dolores, or you found out her parents never spelled it Dolores. You find out that she spells it capital D apostrophe, capital L-O-R-H-E-S-S, or something equally, I'm different.
Yeah, that can be...
Think see, of that.
Instead of actually deriving a new name, they think that just by changing the spelling, that will change
it. Yeah, and we find this actually with certain ethnic and cultural groups that may have come to America or been brought by America that are very proud of their language and their ancestral traditions and all, but they've forgotten what these were.
Yeah,
I'm not going to pick on any specific group, as this happens with several, and I don't want to get nasty lips, and I don't want to hurt anyone's feelings gratuitously. But for instance, there are people who know that their ancestors came from another country, another continent, and they have an idea. It could be a stereotyped and false idea, or it could be a rather true idea of what that particular language sounds like. In other words, they know what letters, maybe what sounds people think of as typical. So instead of actually researching, and maybe they were not always able to research what language, you know, what names sounded like in whatever language they traditionally believe they could trace their ancestry to, there have been people who have sat down and literally made up, and I'm going to name different names so that I'm not offending a Polish sounding name or a Swahili sounding name or a Hebrew sounding name or a Yiddish sounding name or a Gaelic sounding name or, you know, a Swedish sounding name, but it would be one that never existed in that language as a name or anything else. But boy, does it sound Russian or Swedish or Portuguese or Spanish or French or Japanese or what have you.
Well, you know, one of the things about European culture is that in most European culture languages, they think of names as the sound of the name.
Yes.
But in other cultures, the name isn't the sound of the name. It's the meaning of the name.
That's true.
And then when they go to a different country, they don't just transliterate their name. They will actually translate it.
Yeah, and you saw this a lot with immigrants here, although more with last names. You know, someone gets off the boat from Finland and his name was Maki, and three generations later, his grandchildren are Hill. And you see it a lot in, you know, think about, well, I could give examples from almost any group. Now, it is true that they often do think of the sound and, oh, I decided to name my son Gustav Franz because I like the sound of it, yeah, as opposed to whatever that meant. And, you know,
because those names are not transparent. They're not transparent.
And of course,
they're borrowed.
Someone from history. It could be that someone names his son Gustav because he's a big fan of King Gustav of Sweden from a long time ago and a big fan of Franz Liszt. But in some languages of Europe, it actually is much more transparent than others. For instance, a lot of names in Russian and in Polish, you know, other than names which have been borrowed from other languages like French or German or English, a lot of the names that are native to that language are actually words in the language, just like a very few of our English names, just as there are American and English girls named Hope. So there are Russian girls named Nadezhda, of which the nickname is Nadia. And Nadezhda means hope.
Yes.
So they are actually more conscious and they will actually put a lot more thought into the meaning. That actually got very weird during the Russian Revolution in the Stalinist times because they were thinking about the meaning and there was sort of a movement like, well, let's not do names that, you know, come from Christianity because, like, that's the opiate of the masses to have anything that is a religion other than Marxism, you know. So there were some people who'd been named names that they thought of as coming from various Christian cultures that would change this. For instance, there was one person who became rather famous whose name, when she was born, she was given the name Nina Kulagina. Kulagina was her last name. She was born slightly before the Russian Revolution when it became popular to change the names. And she ended up having basically a fake psychic act. You know, basically she pretended to be able to see things with her eyes blindfolded. She basically had a lot of tricks going and she had like this fake psychic act she did in vaudeville and she became, you know, Russian vaudeville, I guess, you know, and she became big there about the time that, shall we say, you know, the Bolsheviks were becoming big. So what she did was to be sort of boost her popularity a little, she picked a name that people were naming their kids. In other words, if you don't name your kid Nina after whatever, you know, non-Russian or possibly saint's name that was, go for Ninel, which was Lenin spelled backwards. So her early publicity has her as Nina Kulagina. And then, like, for 50 years till she died, she was Ninel Kulagina. And there were literally, I mean, they were so into names. There were actually cases in Russia after the revolution of people naming their kids, you know, the Russian word for electricity or railroad or for that matter, flag or something, just because this was something that was new. You know, not that, you know, all I can say is I am very glad not to have been named, you know, not to have been someone who was living there would be named, you know, red Marxist flag or something, which someone apparently was, you know. And in China, apparently, there were people at the same time who literally were named names that translated as the East is red or something like that. I don't know. This is what
well,
I heard.
Yeah, in Mandarin also, names are quite transparent because, you know, usually it's two morphemes, which is, you know, two syllables, and you usually know what each of them mean. Because, you know, there are only a few that might have one syllable that is so old, so archaic that the average person doesn't actually.
Right, and for us, it would be most of our names, even if they were English. I mean, how many people think that William was once Will plus Helmet? You know, how many people think that?
Mm-hmm.
Probably only the people who read baby name books or are
language. Well, yeah, but what I'm saying is there's a great deal more transparency.
Yeah, but if you really want the transparency kings of the world, you know, as far as naming goes, look at the Semitic languages, at least Hebrew, with which I'm familiar.
Yes,
and
yes.
Arabic, where I know some of the naming conventions. After all, think of how many Hebrew names, perfectly short, ordinary names, are actually sentences.
Yes,
Elio.
Absolutely.
In other words, the God of the Jews is God. Or Reuven, you all see a son. A name that was given by a woman to her first child, and she had a son, and she'd been desperate to have one.
Right?
Reuven. Yeah. And you speak Hebrew. You may not have noticed that.
Yeah, you know, yes, I do know that.
But for you, there are people who don't. You know, that is sometimes, if you ask any rabbi who's helping an expectant Jewish couple pick out the name.
Well, you know, the Jews are different from the Hebrew speakers. You do know
that's true, right? That's true. Okay. You know, not all Jews are Hebrew speakers by a long shot. Not all Hebrew speakers are Jews by a long shot.
That's right.
But where the rub is that there are Jews who are not necessarily Hebrew speakers, but want a Hebrew name for their kid in addition to the name in English or whatever country they're living in. And typically they might go and look at Jewish name sources on the internet, or if they go to a rabbi, rabbis, I'm told very reliably, hate this. In other words, a Jewish couple will sign up and they say, oh, I want to have a Hebrew name for our son or our daughter that's going to be born. We know it's a little girl. We'd like to pick a girl's name and can we take like the first half of my mom's name and the second half of his mom's name and glue? And like, usually not, you know, usually it wouldn't even.
Yeah. What I'm saying is that the Hebrew Bible, it has been translated to many, many, many languages
right.
around the world. And in most translations, the names are not translated. So
right. A lot of the better translations will have footnotes. Now, what gets really annoying is when it gets translated, not just from Hebrew into English, let's say, but when it gets translated into another language and the translation is not even done out of Hebrew, it's done out of, you know, the King James Version or something. Mm-hmm. I'll tell you a story. I actually have a friend in Uganda, Africa, whose native tribal language it's pronounced Ruchiga. It's spelled Rukiga, but it happily be pronounced Ruchiga because of a rule in that language, a phonological rule. Mm-hmm. And he is, you know, very much a Bible reader, Bible believer. And because of him, if I ever have a reason to quote the Bible at him in conversation, which I sometimes do to prove a point, well, I actually found a Ruchiga language Bible on the internet. And if I want to quote something at him, I look up that chapter and verse and do it in his language. Well, one thing I noticed is that if you look at names, I was wondering, you know, okay, so how are biblical names, Hebrew names, you know, rendered? You know, how did it come out? And I found out, well, a lot of them, they literally just took the King James English version of the name, you know, and turned it into, you know, something that would be pronounceable in the language that doesn't use some of the sounds of English, that has different rules about where different sounds get to come, different phonotactics. And some of them, they took from Arabic, again, also altered to basically fit how Ruchiga pronounces things.
So who translated their Bible?
For instance, I'll just give an example. Jethro, a big character in the Bible, Moses' father-in-law. How did they have his name pronounced? You would have expected them to go back to Hebrew. Why not go back to Yethro, which was his name? But no, they took the English version, Jethro, and made it fit Ruchiga. And in the Ruchiga Bible, Moses' father-in-law is Yesero. And what is Moses? Musa. Why is Moses Musa? Because that's Arabic, and they knew about Moses from, you know, the Arabic people.
But I'm asking, Kate, is who translated their Bible? Because I know a lot of Bibles are translated by the Summer Institute of Linguistics.
No, it was not by them. It was done earlier. The Summer Institute of Linguistics is a great place, and they have the world's coolest fonts that look gorgeous, and you should get them because they are free for all commercial usages, and they're better looking than basically anyone else's fonts if you want a good, plain, decent font that comes in a lot of varieties. And they have, you know, symbols for like hundreds of sounds, you know, everything imaginable. I mean, whatever you may say about them, they do a bang up job on fonts and you know, linguistics. I mean, they're pretty good people in that context. They did not do it. If they did it, from what little I know of them, they probably would have stuck closer to the original and taken that and just made it pronounceable in a new tongue. But, you know, but looking at this, so it was sort of weird to go through this, especially, you know, when I look, you know, decided to look at, well, you know, how are the things translated? Like when I looked at the names of the books of the Bible, I saw the book of Psalms was Zaburi. No surprise, because Psalms in Arabic is Zabur, and you have to put a vowel at the end to make it fit Ruchiga. So that's what they did. So that's one of the very few Ruchiga words that I ever have been able to remember, because it ties into a word that I already knew from having some Muslim friends. And, you know, and they're aware that King David, you know, wrote the Psalms, and they will, you know, talk about that as they esteem David as
well. You know, Zamo and Mizmo don't.
Yeah,
they come from the same root.
Yeah, okay. It's obviously related in some way, although they in Arabic have a B in the middle, Zabur. But anyway, what's cool is that it's like such terminology. You know, the ones I remember are naturally the ones that existed in another language that were borrowed. You know, I mean, I can say very few things. Like I can say like hello and thank you. And my friend taught me how to say happy birthday, but I forgot it. I wrote it down. I said it like 50 times, but I still forgot it. You know, at one point, one of his sisters has my birthday, and I wanted to record myself wishing her happy birthday. And my friend taught me how to say it, you know, and I said it, but I wrote it down, you know, but I did forget it. But in any case, it was very weird to see what happened. I'll tell you why I'm getting to this. Well, at one point, I learned how to say Merry Christmas, which is Noheri Nungi. And it turns out Noheri is a borrowing. It's Noel. Uh-huh. They had French missionaries at one point. Uh-huh. And you don't really have a difference between L and R and Ruchiga. That's one of the things where, you know, they have trouble. My friend's English is great now, but at one point he used to make writing errors. Like he was writing, he asked if someone was still alive, and he wrote, "Is he still arrive?" And I was confused, because he wrote the word arrive, you know, correctly spelled. He didn't remember which word was which. I will tell you that whoever worked out Ruchiga has the Roman alphabet, and I'm reading this up only because whoever arranged it for them was very smart. The standard order actually is like our alphabetical order, but it puts all the vowels first, and then they do all the consonants. And I was thinking, wow, I wish we did that, because that would be great. Let's just say, I just wish we did that, because it would probably simplify learning a little. At least you would have some similar sounds grouped together. Be that as it may, I don't control how the alphabet ends up. You know, the only reason I'm a crusader, if that's not the right word, really, that I'm a handwriting hothead, is that with handwriting, you have a hope of changing things, because you can change people's minds and behaviors one by one, instead of having to sit them all down and all agree that, you know, we are now going to spell color without a U or something. Anyway, okay. Have we any other comments, either from Mr. Marquette or any of our other regulars?
I'm afraid not. William, did you ever want to explain to us the Taco Bell and KFC remark? Because
I'm not sure. Part of his, shall we say, unique vision of the universe, of which we had a little taste last month.
Yes. Yes.
I will tell you, you know, I've heard of a lot of, there have been a lot of, you know, let's just say it's easy to come up with theories in the absence of historical knowledge. It's easy, you know, for instance, you know, I actually, unfortunately, have met a couple of people who thought, for instance, that the word gay must have been made up by the homosexuals and must have always meant that which it means now, simply because, unlike me, they're a trifle too young to remember when it was just a synonym for happy, when you could have a song about the Flintstones having a gay old time, or, you know, I will tell you, or some other things. I will tell you, I actually freaked out one of those individuals once, knowing that she sang Christmas carols. I said, "Oh, do you know the words to Deck the Hall?" And, you know, and she started singing. She sort of trailed off about halfway through. "Oh, I can never remember that bit." And I said, "You want to look it up?" "Okay, gone we now are gay apparel." And it freaked her out, because she, as a young woman of 30-something, this was a couple of years ago, she had never, literally never heard of this word meaning anything but happy. She'd never happened to be exposed to any older literature in school, you know, be it books in the earlier 20, be it books in the 20th century or be it.
Well, then she's obviously not a reader.
She's not a reader, but remember, a lot of us are not readers. A lot of people are not readers, and that is what freaks some people out when they get onto the internet. Once you're on the internet, it's easier for you to be a reader. That's actually something that the book touches on, that people's relationship to writing is getting a lot stronger and is sort of starting to overshadow the relationship to speech. We've all seen people sit next to each other and text to each other when they could just as well be talking.
Yeah.
Well, these days, if you're, even if you just never read a lot, you know, you read the headlines of the newspaper and, you know, maybe the last book you read was the driver's education manual or something, you know, how to drive your car, you know, once you get onto the internet, you've got just a stream of words, information being pumped at you. And it's hard to avoid all the things that you sort of bleeped over. In other words, you might have grown up hearing kids walking down the street singing Christmas carols sort of in the background. You're not really aware of it. You know, maybe it's played on the recording, you know, system at the supermarket and you sort of tune it out. But once you realize, yeah, I can look up all the words to all the things, you look it up and you see things. I've known people, for instance, and this very much gets into writing. A lot of the book is about how our image of what we do, of what our language behavior is very different from the behavior itself, both in speaking and in writing. For instance, a lot of people have all their lives thought the certain word or name or place name was spelled in a certain way because it just never really came up. You know, I didn't know Afghanistan had an H in it, that kind of thing. You know, they heard about the place, they might have seen it sort of, you know, breeze past it because, you know, these things, you know, your eyes just skim things when you read. But, you know, if you go and you see it coming up all day in the news whenever there's a new war in Afghanistan, and then you say, oh my god, I mean, I've even known people who actually have wondered if, you know, maybe things were being changed, you know, like did they change the name of the place because I didn't remember Connecticut having that C before the letter T. Yeah, the fact is they didn't remember. Mm-hmm. I mean, just to give you an observation on how easy it is to change memories, you know, we all think our memories of things we read, see, write are just going to be ironclad. We think that if we see something in writing, we're going to remember it. But that's not true. And there was an experiment that proved it was not true. This is not in the book, but I'm mentioning it as a thought to leave you to, because one of the points the book makes, I think, whether they meant to make it or not, is that we're unperceptive about our own language and about what we do with our own language. And this was proven by experiment and memory, which was not covered in the book. This experiment was done by people who wanted to see, could you mess with people's memories of having gone to Disneyland? Which you'd think everyone who goes there remembers. I mean, we know Disneyland, it's great and everything, you know? You know, could you make people specifically falsely remember having seen Bugs Bunny at Disneyland when Bugs Bunny isn't a Disney character? He's a Warner Brothers Universal character, right? You know, if you walked up dressed like the Bugs Bunny character to Disney, they wouldn't think you worked there. They'd kick you out. So here's what they did. They recruited people who'd been to Disneyland at some fairly recent time, even as recently as 6 months ago, or maybe a couple years ago, or maybe when they were kids. And they told them, we're going to have you in a group to test some new ads for Disneyland. We want to, you know, have you read these ads and tell us what you think about them. And we're going to check you on things you remember from the ads and if they stirred any memories of when you had been to Disneyland earlier in your life. And they recruited people who'd been to Disneyland. And they had them in this waiting room where they were going to go in and look at some ads and, you know, take a quiz on the ads. And the waiting room was your perfectly ordinary little, you know, waiting room, you know. Of course, it had magazines, which were magazines about Disney, and posters on the wall about Disney. And there was like a little, you know, video playing in the corner about Disney. But these things had been a little edited in some way. For instance, for one group, all of the videos had Bugs Bunny put in like, you know, let's talk with Laurie. And she went on a visit to Disneyland. And here she is talking about how excited she was to shake the hand of Bugs Bunny in the Magic Kingdom, you know. Or someone talking about how I remember my first trip to Disneyland when I was 5 years old, and it was a trip for my birthday, and oh, I was so excited. And so some of these were in a situation that went a whole lot into Bugs Bunny. Some of them were just standard actual Disney things just in one corner. You know, there might be an ad that mentioned, go to the Magic Kingdom and see Bugs Bunny and shake his hand. Or in one case, there was just a cardboard cutout of Bugs Bunny under the Magic Kingdom castle. You know, just that. Everything else was straight up real Disney. And they had them sit around, wait, you know, fill out a survey about, like, when, how many times you've been to Disney, when were these times, did you like it, what do you really remember, you know, and have you, did you go alone or with people, you know, your usual marketing survey. And they took these surveys and then brought people in to, you know, basically do more surveys. And at a certain point they said, when you were at Disney, did you get to meet and greet any of the following Disney characters? And they put all the characters people dress up as, like, you know, Mickey and Donald and Goofy, and they threw in there, somewhere in there, Bugs Bunny. And a lot of people, even a lot of people who'd been to Disney 6 months ago, said, yeah, I remembered Bugs Bunny, and I shook his hand, Paul, whatever, and he was eating a carrot, and he said, yeah, what's up, Doc? Which he didn't, because, you know, the guys in the costumes don't talk, because it's hard to talk in those costumes, you know. The mascots who are, you know, dressed up as just people, like Snow White or whatever, they will talk to you, you know, but not the guys in the animal suits, you know, or the gals in the animal suits. Some of them are ladies. And so if we, you know, and so if this is something that they had just been sitting in a room reading about Disney, writing about Disney, talking about Disney, and somehow someone had been able literally to implant that memory into their head. And when they got them out, they took them into the next room and said, oh, here's what's been done to you. They were, I can't believe Disney's not in, that Bugs Bunny doesn't play in Disney, you know? And they thinking, oh my God, yeah, how I now remember, how could I have just been so stupid? So, you know, it could be that, just as the spoken word, that the written word can also be powerful in shaping what we think before we even know what we're thinking.
Yeah, so that's why, you know, books that are electronic are kind of dangerous, because they can change for you without your knowing. That's why I keep a lot of printed books in my house.
Yeah, Amazon actually once removed 1984 for 2 weeks of all things. They said it was because of a copyright issue. Now, they can be changed, but, you know, you can prevent that. You can get PDFs and save them and print them out. You can save something and put it on offline storage or even something in Dropbox. Now, remember, they cannot change everything, because old versions do exist. Now, Mr. Manket has explained Taco Bell and KFC. I heard that from a Kanye West song. Now, I am not a follower of Kanye West. Certainly not now. I do not know how deep his apology went. What I'm going to do is I'm going to take a moment. Since I have a Mac out here, I'm going to see if I can get into, you know, I'm going to see if I can get into Safari and Google Taco Bell, KFC, Kanye West, because Mr. Manket, he's been so persistent that I think we need to have a clue about what he's been talking about. I'm going to Taco Bell and KFC in a Kanye West song. Yes, my Mac takes dictation, which is much an improvement over. If you want to, you know, if you want to do a service on how, a series on a newbie learning how to deal with the Mac and everything that is Apple, I will do this. You can configure a MacBook, you know, 13, you know, which is not even one of the new ones, to take dictation. You can even pick what key to press twice to let it take dictation. So I actually picked the key that gives me the keyboard, because this way if I hit it once, I get a keyboard. If I hit it twice, I can get dictation. I'm still waiting for it to. What's the title of the song with KFC? And apparently it has the same beat. I haven't seen the song, but apparently it has the same beat as Hush Little Baby, Don't You Cry. It's something I'm looking. People have actually asked it. Lord, I need you, the Kim song, our Savior. I don't know what is the relevance to our topic or our series of topics and
digressions. It's something about, it's the best collab since Taco Bell and KFC. Oh, you know, at one point, they put Taco Bell and KFC in the same building.
Right. They often are in the same building, if you've noticed.
Yes, they weren't before, but this happened, you know, in this millennium. I think that
The company is now shared. It's probably one company probably bought out the other because that happens a lot. You know, there are companies you can buy stock in that you've never heard of, you know, that turn out to own half a dozen fast food chain restaurants. Literally. That's my lights going. It means 11:30. Let me put the lights back on. I don't like to be in the dark unless I am winding down to go to sleep. Alexa, work lights. Wait, it's going to come. Come on. Don't tell me you're not going to work on me this time. Alexa, work lights. There you go.
Sometimes okay, so there's no rebellion. I was afraid it was like 2001, Odyssey.
Sometimes mechanical systems don't pick up my voice for whatever reason. No one can isolate why. I mean, I'm loud enough. They're trained in a variety. Thank you. By the way, I do go by Ms., although I am married. The song called Lord, I Need You. Well, I'm not familiar with this. And for one reason or another, I will not play Kanye West on the air. And the reasons are not just that YouTube would, you know, be very nasty to us for playing something copyrighted. So, but thanks for explaining so well, Mr. Manket, or if I may call you William. I'm wondering why you did bring up that song just now. I know there was probably some connection between that and something we said that's obvious to you and not to us and maybe not to others. Would you be able to just tell us what that was? Because I've been curious. Right now I'm going to Google. Lyrics of the song, Lord, I Need You by Kanye West. No, it's not doing it. It's not doing it. You know, anyone who knows, has known me for years will tell me that sometimes machines don't want to register that I'm in the room. Lyrics of the song, Lord, I Need You by Kanye West. Let's get this up. Hope it has the lyrics. I'm not going to recite them. Okay, it looks like basically a very, I don't know. It starts out looking like this religious song, and then it's sort of a romance, and there's a line. It's the best collab since Taco Bell and KFC. That's what he must have meant. I hope you meant, William, that we are a good collaboration.
Okay, that would be great.
Anyway, anything else? This has been a little more rambling than usual. I will be honest, I am at a loss when reviewing things that are very technical because I'm never sure how deep to go. I'm never sure. But I tried to give a taste of the sorts of things he looked at and the sorts of questions, if not, you know, that you can see others deal with by reading this book. But I would say take it in small, small doses. I would say that this is not going to be your summer reading at the beach. You know, save this for when you're stuck on the Greyhound bus during some 12-hour traffic jam because it will take that long to get through it. And you'll want something, you know, and you'll want something, well, let's just say it's worth reading. It's one of the things that I would say it's worth reading. And for the time being, it's free, FREE, and I hope you're going to tell us. And I would say the best way to do that is literally take one chapter a month and do a few pages a day. I mean, I practically choked trying to get that whole thing down. But I would say if you want a book that's going to make you think and you want a book that's going to outrage you sometimes and you want a book that's going to tell you things like, oh, my God, I always knew this was true, but I couldn't see how. Sometimes this is the book for that.
That's a wonderful recommendation, Kate.
Thank you. Okay. So I hope to post some. I hope to post something. I will tell you, I'm just exhausted now. I was up a wee bit early because, okay, my husband had a medical issue. He had to go for a follow-up checkup, and fortunately, everything is okay, but he had to leave quite early in the day to do it. I would say everything's okay, but so much as everything's getting okay. He's always been in fundamentally good health, and he had an excellent surgeon. And I don't want to go into his problem, because let's just say you have to know me to a certain amount before I will talk about personal problems of family members and whatever. But let's just say he seems to be good as new, or at least if not good as new, at least 90% of the way to getting there physically. Wonderful. Physically. And don't worry, he's fine upstairs. It was a physical problem, and we all get them at some point or other. Okay?
Yes.
Anyway, what shall we talk about next week? I'd like to, I would, one thing you could mention, and I would have mentioned it other than that we had this topic planned, is that quite recently I was in the New York Times. Okay. There was a comment column, but by the time they got like 900 comments, but by the time I was even free to look at it, owing to my schedule, it had already been closed. So I did not comment. One comment actually mentioned me, and there were some comments I thought were ridiculous, but some comments I thought were very on point. Some of them were even recommending specific books or approaches that I happen to like, because there were comments on a column, of course, about messy handwriting, and I was interviewed as one of the people who deal with this. Anyway, we may or may not have some more developments. I would like you, if you don't mind, since I don't think we have any consensus on what should be next month, but I think probably academic book reviews are probably not the best way to go.
Okay.
I'm thinking, maybe very, very rarely, unless we could find a book that's a little less technical and is maybe a little more relatable, and there is such. I would like you to ask what should be the next month's topic.
And I will run a poll.
Don't get an answer, and leave choices and let people pick more than one choice. And if we don't like, and warn them that if we don't like any of the choices, we're going to roll our own. I might end up doing anything. We could, one thing we might even do, if we don't get any better choices, I'm wondering if we can talk about the scripts of invented languages, such as the Elvish from the Tolkien books.
Oh, that would be very
good. Tolkien was actually a pretty good amateur calligrapher, and he was a linguist, and he actually used his knowledge to make the writing system, as well as the language, look realistic. Other people have done other scripts for their invented languages, known as constructed languages or conlangs, and which means that confusably a constructed writing system for one of them gets called a conscript. And there are a few, and this is probably a lot more fun topic, because there are people who have made up a language to use just with their friends as children. Not many of them ever made up a writing system, though some of them do. And of course, there are people these days, there's a lot of language construction going on because people make movies about fantasy countries and have the different languages in there. I mean, not just in the movies, Game of Thrones had 3 or 4 fantasy languages. Star Trek had a couple, and we could hear bits of them on the air. And you can actually get Duolingo courses to teach you to speak Dothraki, which was the dominant language in the Game of Thrones civilization, or Klingon. Or I don't know if they do Elvish, but if they don't, someone is doing Elvish, which, by the way, is a pretty, pretty, pretty language. If you ever, there are actually people who have taught themselves to speak Elvish, even to the point of coming up with Elvish consistent coinages for modern things like hamburgers and television. Because there are literally people who go off and have events with their friends, and like, we're going to go off with the woods, and we're going to, speak nothing but Elvis for a week. That actually is apparently a big thing in Russia. They're called Tolkienists over there, and the government apparently thinks it's some kind of anti-government thing because they're persecuting them as, I guess being out of line with Russian culture or whatever. Look, I don't know about you, but I'm glad that when I visited Russia, it was before they did that, although it was in the middle of them doing a lot of other horrible things. I do not think I would like to live in a country where people think that Lord of the Rings is a subversive political plot. Anyway, well, if we have no better suggestions, our next one would be the scripts of invented languages, because there are lots to choose from. And a lot of them have websites. So once we know if that's the topic, it would be a lot easier for me to do. All I have to do is go to these websites. And even some of the constructed languages that use Roman alphabet scripts may use them in their own unusual ways. They may have diacritics, or they may do odd things with capitals. Although mostly I'll be looking at languages that had an invented script rather than borrowing one that already existed. I might look at some that took a script and changed it, but well, we'll see. And if anyone wants the topic, and if anyone happens to have their favorite invented language that they know about and they want to say, oh, why don't you do from this, that, or the other? If I haven't learned about it, I'll try to learn about it in order to say something intelligent. And that could be interesting, because instead of talking about just one thing all evening, we'll get to talk about lots of things. And of course, if anyone out there ever made up their own language or their own writing system, even if it was just secret code for your diary by replacing every letter with a, you know, something else, send it in. Let us know. It could be fun. It could be a lot of fun. Tolkien actually referred to language invention as a private, vice. And, not so much that it was bad, but it's like something you love so much you go off and do it on the sly and you'd be embarrassed if anyone knew, like the people who are like into My Little Pony, even if they're 40-year-old men, they're just into it, but they'd be embarrassed if maybe their boss found out they're reading a comic book that was written for little girls, Anyway, yeah. Got to get off. I hope that this has been pleasant and productive. Perhaps you could encourage other people to show up. I'm wondering if perhaps we get more people, even before we have the link, what if you were to promote the topic, even before you get a picture from me, and even before you have a link, you could always promote the topic with a slide beforehand that would simply ask questions or say sort of cool teaser type things. Okay. Even because that way, if that was out there a week before, and I'm saying this because I feel guilty because I am just exhausted because things have been a little hard for me. My husband has, let's just say, about a month of recovering before he can lift or push anything over 10 pounds, 45 kilograms for you everyone but America types. So, I have been having to do the one who puts things in the fridge and takes out the trash or whatever, Not this horrible. I don't mind it. It has to be done, but I've been doing things that normally I don't do, and sometimes I get a little more exhausted than I should,
That's okay. I understand.
But he'll be fine. And anyway, I've got to get off, and let's see what the next month brings, okay? Thank you.
Okay, very good. Thank you, Kate.
Thank you.
And everybody else, good night, and please subscribe.
Thank you. Let's blow this joint.